Okay, if we can start, because today we have also a lot of material to cover, and I wanted hopefully to have some time to at the end go over the assignments and discuss a little bit. I don't know if you guys are thinking of doing something. So today we will go again a bit more into the conceptual aspect. We'll look into the reactive combinators or operators in detail. Not all of them extensively, but the ones that I think illustrate or are kind of representative of the kind of things you can do. So they will give you, they should give you a good basis to think about everything else. So the goal is that by the end of the day, nothing should really feel strange in bonsai anymore, okay? There should at least be some kind of intuition of how things might work. And even if you come across some operator that you don't know about, you should be able to kind of get a feeling of how it might be working or even imagine new operators. So that's the goal for today. Again, be reactive, ask questions. Same thing as always. There are some operators that we will not be covering, so if you're interested in learning about a specific one that is not here, you can ask. Okay, so this is where we are in our program. So we're already at the midpoint, past the midpoint. There's only two more days to go. And today we will talk about, as I said, observable combinators. And the idea is that they really give you kind of an algebra, a way to really manipulate and create new data streams that is quite powerful for doing a synchronous program. But before we go in there, I just wanted, because I remember Zach was asking for a glossary, and I remember that there's this figure from the bonsai paper that is can be useful as a reference, which gives you just a short description of the various nodes, like the color coding behind each node, with a short description. So you have sources, the combinators are kind of like the main kinds of nodes. Then you have transforms. We've seen them. Conditions. We didn't talk about them explicitly, but we will. But the idea is that they are basically filters on your data stream. So if you remember, we talked in the first class about the where operator that can specify a condition for which elements are allowed to go through. That's what the conditions do. And I'll show you, we can talk about how you specify them in bonsai very easily. Sinks we've seen, properties we've seen, and also nested, we've seen some examples. Okay, nested workflows, and we will discuss some more of them today.
A red one.
Our red one is error. When there's an error, any node will become red. Okay, so today is, as I said, observable combinators, and this will just be really a discussion combinator by combinator in an order that I think it will be useful. We will just be looking mostly at marble diagrams and maybe some bonsai running examples. Okay, so let's start with the simple ones. So the first one is, which we'll look at, is take. So take is very simple. Is you have an observable stream with inputs, and you say, for example, take the first four elements. That's what take, how it should be read. Take the first four, and the result is a stream that only has four elements. So after the fourth element, it emits uncompleted. It completes, and that's it. And everything else is ignored. And one important point to realize is that when the uncompleted fire, so when the four elements arrive, the take unsubscribes from the original stream, okay? So if you have logic associated with like some kind of, imagine if it's a database connection or a network connection, and data is coming through the connection, what take would do is take the first four elements, and after it's done, it would cut the connection, okay? So it would close everything. So it's not just ignoring, it's really closing, stops the whole subscription. So it's important for those if you have side effects on there. So the complement of this is of this operator is skip. It also exists. You can say, for example, skip two, and this essentially means take the input stream, ignore the first two elements, and then emit everything after that. Okay. You also have, I don't have them here, I can write them on the board. There's also take last and skip last, which are the same, but for the last elements. And there's actually a trick, maybe it's good that I write them here, just for one reason, is if you have, let's say it's like this, something like this, and you have, let's say, take last, class 2, for example, one important thing to realize is that how does take last know which ones are the last? Okay, so the reason what it has to do is it has to wait for this uncompleted. Okay, so what it's doing here is really having a buffer of two elements always, where it stores everything going in, and then when the uncompleted arrives, if you subscribe to this guy, it will replay the, let's say, this is A, B, C, D. It will replay C and D over here. Okay? And then complete. Okay? That's how it would work. And there's also a trick for take last. Okay? And then there's also a trick, maybe I should have put in here. Well, actually, it doesn't really matter, but for skip last, the trick is you have to delay, right? So if you're skipping the last two, then you have to kind of wait two values before you send out, because you never know if your value is going to be the last one. Is it clear? Should I draw that, or is it clear from the description?
The idea quickly has some doubts. So if I do skip last, skip last two, okay. What I have to do is really, when the first element arrives, I cannot send it out, because it may be the last one, there's no way to know, okay.
And then this one arrives, and I also still cannot send it out, because I can skip two. And then when this guy arrives, I send out the first one. So over here, for example. Because now it's safe. Now it's safe to send it out because I know that there's no way that he can be the last one, one of the last two. And the same here. But then, of course, if. And then if you have the whenever the uncompleted.
Skip last.
Okay, so this is just to bear in mind that these two, the way they are logically organized, they force some modifications on the register.
Also, that little vertical line means that it's
completed. It's all completed. Means it's
the same of the subscribe.
It's the same as on unsubscribing. So. It terminates, so when you get an uncompleted, you close the connection, you close the subscription. So subscribe would be the beginning.
Yeah, and
subscribe. I didn't have subscribe. Yeah, exactly. Of course, the unsubscribe, we tend not to use it so much in these diagrams, but sometimes there can be an exception, so an error. An error also causes an unsubscribe. If there's an error, it can be sent out and then it will be closed. This one we also saw in the first day, sum, which basically accumulates over the whole sequence, and then when the uncompleted arrives, it gives you the sum of all the elements. But you also have other kinds of aggregates that you can use, namely count, min, max, average. All of these compute these kind of aggregation over the whole data stream. Okay, so if you want to know how many elements arrived, what was the min, the max, or the average, you can use them. They follow the exact same marble diagram, just replacing the operation that is done. Now, this is just for a single input combinators. But now let's move on to combinators that use two inputs. Okay? So now we start to merge. So now you have two sources of data, and you're kind of merging them together in some way. And there are many ways. So one of the ways is take until. So take until is essentially the same as take. But now instead of you specifying a number for how many elements you're taking, there's now another data stream that provides the event for when the take should when you should stop taking, basically. Okay. So in this case, it's the same as before. You have four elements, and then the little event arrives, and then take until emits the uncompleted. Okay, and closes the connection to this guy. It's important. So for example, this is a way for you to dynamically, for example, close a data stream. Okay, you can just, if you have some event you want to use it to close, you can use take until.
Any event doesn't need to.
Any event, yeah. So the data type of the second guy doesn't matter. It can be anything you want. Okay. There is an error in the slide in the title. Maybe I can correct it quickly. You should really call skip until. Okay. So skip until is the same. Again, it's skip but with an event. So now basically the original stream is silenced until is ignored. All the elements are ignored until there's an event. Okay, and then when the event arrives, then everything is proceeds from there. Okay, so it's another way to dynamically kind of start getting values from the data stream. Another way still to control acquisition is sample. And ask, so stop me adding, emphasize that if I'm going too fast or anything, please stop me. But okay, so then you have sample. Sample is now on. Is a bit different. So now sample, what it means is you have again an input stream, okay. But now the sample will only send out a value when the second stream fires or it's a value, okay. So in here you see, and it sends out. So let's say here it starts with this first element, okay, this hexagon orange, and then a value arrives on the second stream. Okay, at that moment, sample will emit the latest value that it had stored. Okay. So the idea is that even if your stream is irregular, let's say this stream is irregular and this one is regular, then the values will be sampled at that particular frequency. And so here, for example, you see that this value is dropped, okay? Because it arrived, it was stored, but then this guy arrived and it became the latest. So then when the sample arrives, it's this value that is sent out, and you never get to see this one, okay? So this may be useful if you want, for example, to control the rate, if you have something that is going too fast, and you just want to have another master that kind of tells when you get values, you can use sample for that. There's two important catches to realize. One is here illustrated, is that when the sample data stream, the second one, completes, if there are any pending values on the first one, they will be sent out immediately. The last value will be sent out if it's pending. So a little detail. And another detail that is important is that each value will only be sent out once, meaning that imagine that this guy arrives, okay, and then before this one, so you get this one, you get sample, you get the value, and then before this one arrives, imagine there was another sample here, okay? If this was the case, then sample would not emit the same value again. So you cannot generate duplicates with sample, okay? It's just an important point. Questions about sample? I don't know if this was clear.
So it's a really good process. For sampling, is kind of timer?
You can use a timer. Yeah. So sample. Actually, there's a version of sample called sample interval. If you just want a periodic kind of time-based version, you can just use sample interval, and you pass the parameter with the interval, the time interval you want to periodically
sample. I just don't understand the difference between the sample and the time passed, because it's usually
So take the main difference. Well, so take last, or take until, you're saying.
Because simple takes the last value. Uh-huh. Also takes the last value.
Ah yes, but it only works. So there's two differences. One is that take last only works once. So it's basically say take last, and you are locked to the uncompleteness, and you cannot kind of. You cannot sample the sequence many times over time. And the other difference is that take last, the buffer is of the size of the number you put in take last. And here in sample, the buffer is only of one sample, one element. Okay.
Subscribe when in sample.
Subscribe when is different. We can discuss it, but basically subscribe when is as the name implies, you subscribe when the event arrives. So in this case, the difference between, for example, let's say the difference between skip until and subscribe when. Okay, so skip until connects to the original sequence, so it subscribes to the sequence, but it's simply ignoring the elements. So for example, if it's a camera, you can think that the camera is initialized, it started, but all the frames are ignored until you get the event. On the other hand, on subscribe when, the camera is only initialized when you get the event. It's a bit different. You see the difference? So in one, you have a camera open, sending the frames are being ignored. On the other, the camera only opens.
It's the opposite of
skip until. It uses another moment. It uses the it controls the subscription rather than the filter, rather than filtering values. More questions? Okay.
One question. Yeah. Because you have a new principle, I guess you can just turn it around. Is that you create an event whenever the data sample has a certain value?
Yes, so that's the condition. That's a condition. So basically, you want to test you want to test each value for something, and then if it's true, you let it go.
Right. Yeah. Of course.
Yeah. Okay. So if this is clear, now let's go to. Operators that kind of bring data from both, because now we've been seeing operators that kind of control, where you have two streams and one controls the other. Okay, now it's a bit different, is you want to fuse data from two streams. Okay, and there are also many ways to do this. The first one we'll look at is zip, and the way you can think about zip is as a like a zipper, like in your pants. Okay, so the elements are kind of pairwise combined one by one, they're zipped together, okay? And the way it works is the first element is matched, so the first element of the first stream is matched with the first element of the second stream, and then the second element of the first stream is matched with the second element of the second stream, and so on. And the important thing to realize here is that, for example, here, and I need to explain this. So I'm showing the reactive RX marble diagram, where in the RX zip, you have to pass a function here that says how the two values are going to combine to produce the result. Okay. In this case, the way they combine is you take the shape of the, you take the color of the balls in the first stream, and you combine them with the shape of the inputs from the second stream, and you produce kind of like a colored shape. Okay, so you can see here, if this is a magenta diamond, then this guy was combined with this guy. Okay, if this is an orange star, it means this guy was combined with this guy. And this is a blue pentagon, so it was combined with this guy. Okay. Now, this is what, so this should now become clear what I was saying. So the first one arrives, combines with this one, which is the magenta diamond. And now here you get two, before the second event from the second stream arrives, before the star arrives, you receive two events in the first stream. Okay? But still, the one that is combined is the first one that arrived. Okay? Because remember, it's a pairwise combination. So it doesn't matter how fast or how slow any of the streams is, they will be combined in order. So the first with the first, the second with the second, the further, and so on. Maybe it's best to see this. So now we're, maybe it starts being useful to see the
sorry, so yeah. So then the shortest stream dictates how long the resulting one is, right?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, yeah. But this also takes in account, so this is if one stream is consistently slower than the other. But sometimes there's also the case that you can have bursts. For example, sometimes one is faster, then the other one becomes faster, and the other one becomes faster. But really the only thing, the thing that is important to realize here is this is useful for situations where you know, a priori, that there's a one-to-one kind of correspondence between the elements in the stream, and you don't want time to interfere with that pairing. Okay? So it doesn't really matter when the elements arrive, you know, that no matter what, the first one of one stream matches with the second, or the first one from the second stream. Right? That's where zip is useful. And I'll show you one. I can show you. Maybe this is useful to go between bonsai and see an example. So let's say I have here two timers. Okay, one that fires every second, and another one that fires every 2 seconds, for example. So you have here the timers. Okay, so they will basically count timers. So the output of timer is the kind of like the tick count. So it's useful to kind of see these operators working. So now let's zip these two. And in bonsai, two things to say here. One is the order of the inputs to zip, okay, follows the order in which you connect it, okay, and after you connect it, it's also represented graphically, okay. So the order of the inputs is represented from top to bottom. So for example, now it's maybe not clear because they have the same name, but if I, so let's say I disconnect this guy. So this is the 1 second, it's here, and this is a 2 second. If I connect this guy first, and then this guy, now the 2 seconds is above, okay? Because the important thing for you graphically is to see the order of the inputs. So because you want to know that the first input to zip is this guy, and the second input is this guy, okay? That's how you know which one is first and which one is last. Anyway, this is just a note, this applies to all combinators. This order. Okay. Now, if we take this, now you can see zip working. So basically, as you said, the slowest one, or someone said, the slowest one is dictating the pace because in this case they are rhythmic. They are both rhythmic, periodic. And you see that. So what is happening here that you see is that the values from the first stream, they are coming much faster at twice the rate. But they are being stored by zip to be sent out later. Okay, so another thing to realize is that zip uses memory to kind of remember which values are in queue to be sent. Okay, this is important, for example, if you're dealing with images. If you put zip in an inappropriate situation, you may be seeing your memory increase a lot because all the memories are in all the images will be stored. Well, there's plenty of control possible here. No, what I wanted, because there's many operators. It's not just zip. We'll go for all of them. You can control many aspects of how data is used. Okay? So we'll go through that. So one situation where zip is guaranteed to be always meaningful, to always make sense, is when you branch. And this is an important case. So let's say I have a camera, and now I want to have two branches, okay, one grayscale, and another one, let's say, some kind of color conversion, okay? And now I do, let's say, now in these two branches, I did some kind of processing, doesn't matter what. And now I want to kind of do something on the two images together. So let's say, for example, I wanted to add them. So I could use zip and then add. And add here means because add here works because you've combined the two inputs before. So now you have a tuple of two images. You have a tuple of two images, okay? And so add uses that as the argument. So it will add the values from that come from zip together. But the important thing to realize here is that here zip always makes sense. Why? Because when you branch, the values going through one branch are exactly the same as the values going through the other branch. Okay, so they always, it's guaranteed if you branch, it's guaranteed that they will match one by one. There's a guarantee. And so zip always will make sense. If you are branching and just merging. Now, beware that if for some reason you are dropping values in this branch, then this no longer applies, okay? Or may apply, if, I mean, may make sense in your case, depending on... Yeah, it's up to you. It's just for you to be aware that it may or may not be meaningful, depending on the situation.
So add isn't something that can just take the two images?
No, because the idea is that whenever you're bringing two independent data streams together, the way you do that is always ambiguous. So it needs specification. So we could assume, I could assume something by default, but that would be dangerous actually. Because for example, if I assume that it's zip, then it's a problem if the streams are at independent rates. If I assume, let's say, combine latest, which is the next operator, then you could get redundant values, duplicates. So it's like there's no silver bullet that kind of feels right in to be the default. So the decision is to not have default. You have to say how you want the streams to be combined first, and then you do the operation. So that's is it clear? Is it? Yeah. So now let's look at the complement of the zip, which is combine latest. Okay, so the idea here is that, again, you are pairing the two streams, but now you're always pairing, whenever an element arrives, you always take the latest value from the other stream, okay? So in the beginning, combine latest actually acts like zip, but only for the first pairing. And why? Because when the first element arrives, there's nothing to pair it with. Okay, so the result of the function here is undefined, so combined latest cannot do anything. Then when the first element of the second stream arrives, okay, now you have a pairing, so you do it. And now starting from this point, when another element in the first stream arrives, now you pick the latest from the first stream, from second stream. And now you can do a pairing, so immediately. So when this guy arrives, you immediately produce a result, which is now an orange diamond, okay? And now when this guy arrives again, you produce a blue diamond. And then finally the star arrives, and you pair it now with the latest from the first string, and so on, okay? So the idea here is that the combined latest will emit values at the rate of basically kind of a union of the two streams, okay? In a way, it will never lose any values from either. So it's always sending out what's on the other whenever there's new values, okay? Now, what I was saying before in answering Zach, if you would use, for example, if you branch and you instead of let's go, is it questions about the marble diagram? Okay. So here, for example, in this example we were seeing, if I use combine latest, okay, this is still valid. You know, well, it actually, it starts being weird, because what happens is the following. So here, the two branches, they take the same. So when one value, when one image goes through the first branch, it always goes, it also goes through the second branch. Okay. But now what happens here is the following. Whenever, first it's like zip the first time. So you get an image, and then you get the second image, and you do a pair. But now, starting from that point, whenever there's an image going through, you already get a pairing. So the problem, if you see, is that now for every image going through the camera, you actually get two additions. You get one that is the sum of the first guy going through combined latest and the previous guy from the previous frame, okay? And then the correct addition. So the rate will be, it's not probably what you expect in this case, okay? So that's why, for example, the combined latest is not the default. However, if you have two cameras, okay?
There is no with latest one.
Okay, so now if you have two cameras, and now you're doing the same thing, and now you're, let's say this camera is working at 1 hertz, and this camera is working at 30 hertz, okay, two different rates. If you use zip, it would be a problem, because maybe that's not what you mean. Maybe you really want to take the latest in some way, okay? Because you don't want to be delayed, you don't want one to be delayed versus the other, okay? But now you may have a problem, because maybe you want to define a master clock. So for example, let's say you know that this guy is the fastest, or that this guy is the slowest, and you want to use only one of them to produce values in combined latest. Okay? Because in combined latest, if you remember the marble diagram, it produces values on either one of them. So whenever either string produces a value, you get an output. Okay? So if you want to control which one is actually responsible for triggering the computation, you can, after combine latest, you can control that. The simple pattern is, for example, to use sample. Okay. So you can do, for example, this one. If you do this, if you can read, what is happening here? So combine latest is sending values whenever either of them has a new value. However, you're saying, in addition to that, I only want to take values from that when this guy fires. Okay? So now you've paired them before, but you've defined this guy as the master, kind of master clock. Okay? So this pattern is very common, and in fact, it's so common that in the next version of Rx, they will introduce an operator called with latest, which is this thing already built in. So on the next version, this will be kind of combined in one node called with latest. For now, it doesn't exist, but you can do it like that. It's very useful. Often. Okay, this is clear. Another one that is useful, next one is merge. Okay, now merge is as an additional constraint. So, combine latest and zip, you could pair any two data streams. Okay. With merge, what merge is doing is actually just letting you see multiple data streams as if they were only as if only one existed. Okay, so it's like you have many of them and you only want to see one. And for that to happen, merge actually requires that the type of the data going through all the streams is the same. Okay, so that's why it's indicated here that everything is circles in this case. Okay. They are the same data type with different values, the colors in the value. Okay. Now, what merge is doing is simply just flattening all of the time diagrams, all of these marble diagrams for all the sequences are just flattened all down to one common one. Okay, so there's really no, whenever a value arrives in one of the streams, it will arrive at the result, and that's it. Just simple. Another one. Questions about merge? One important point about merge, the detail that make them useful, is when does the result complete? Okay, because you have many of them. And the answer is that it completes when all of the inputs complete. Okay, so this guy, you can see it completed before this one, but doesn't matter, there's still active strings, so their values are being merged down, and then when everyone completes, the output completes. Concat, so string concatenation. So you can, what it does is essentially puts the elements of the subsequent streams after all of the elements of the previous streams have been emitted. Okay, so in this case, we have these two data streams that you can imagine emit values in this kind of time sequence, and one is just, you just take this snippet and you kind of paste it here. Okay. Now, one thing, there's an important thing to realize here about concat is to understand the behavior for, again, hot and cold observables. Okay. So if you remember again, a cold observable is an observable that replays, whenever someone subscribes, it replays always the elements in the same kind of sequence, in same kind of order. So it doesn't, it's replay. You remember replay? It's kind of the canonical cold observable. Okay. So what this happens is that concat here, if this guy fights, so if you see here time is represented as being the shared, okay? So in this case, you can see that this is a cold observable. Why? Because these values are kind of emitted in the sequence, and when this guy ends, the concat subscribes to this guy, and the values appear over here, okay? So this only worked because this stream was a cold observable, okay? Maybe this is not clear, but if this was a hot observable, okay, so hot observable meaning an observable in which if you are late to an event, you miss it. You never see it again. Okay? So if that was true, then by the time this guy completed, then all of the events in this guy are gone. So actually when concat, this is all reactive. So what happens with concat is that concat only subscribes to the second stream when the previous ones, when the first one completed. Okay, so when this guy ends, concat asks this guy, okay, give me your values. And if this was a hot observable, then there was nothing. There would be nothing. It would complete immediately. Okay? Is this clear? This is a subtle point, but it's an important one.
So the second one has to be cold.
Well, maybe not. It can be hot, but it just means that you lose, if it's a hot observable, you lose all the values that were sent out before the first one completed. Okay?
How do you know that you are in something wrong?
Well, it's by construction. You have to know either the definition starts at the
end. You have like a sample.
Yeah, so the way it works is like this. The definition of hot and cold starts at the source. Okay, so for example, a camera, for example, is a hot observable, always. Okay. But for example, we have another one that is range, which is a cold observable, always sends out a sequence of values, the same sequence of values. It's always cold. So if you know the temperature of the source, okay, then you know that the stream will always have that temperature, unless you change it by using either publish or replay, okay? Where you can switch from one, you can either cool down a stream or heat it up. So publish makes it hot, replay makes it cold, and apart from that, it keeps the same temperature. Okay.
It doesn't mean that if you can subscribe to the second data stream in this example, it doesn't mean that the concat will know the previous event. Like
it will know that the first, so to be fair, it will know that the first one, it will know that this guy completed. Okay. It will know that this guy is done, but it will not see any values. So this guy completes, then concat asks, okay, do you have any values? And immediately receives an uncompleted, and then it's done. So that's it.
And the first string is defined by the order.
By the order in the input. So if you put in bonsai, so for example, let's say we can do an example if it's clear. Let's put a timer here. Again, 1 second, and another timer. So 2 seconds. And let's say I take let's say I take 4 values of this guy, and I will concatenate this with this one. Okay? So you should be able to read what is happening here. So I take the first 4 elements of this string that are being produced once a second, and then after that is done, I concatenate to this guy that is sending out every 2 seconds. So if you see the results, it's basically going to be, we lost the first couple of them. It's 0, 1, 2, 3, and then you switch to the other one, and it... It starts being slower. Okay, only 20 seconds.
Near timer, the second timer happens like a cold or something.
Yes, so that's an important point. Timer you can actually consider a cold observable. It's interesting because it respects that the timer is only initialized when you subscribe. Okay, and the counter is only set. It only starts at that moment. So the counter starts at the moment of subscription. So this is actually a way to verify what I was saying, that only when this guy is done, does concat subscribe to this guy. And when it subscribes, the timer is set, and the counter is set to 0, and it starts counting from there. So next one, M. Amb is a funny name. I think it means ambiguous, but I'm not 100% sure, actually. So these are all names from the Rx. They are named like this. When I integrated all the operators in Bonsai, I just used the same names because then it makes it possible for people to just go on their page and search the names, and the documentation is all there. You can read all about all of these in the Rx documentation. So what is AMP doing? So AMP is a race condition, okay? So what it means is if you have multiple data streams connected to AMP, the first one to give an element wins everything, okay? So kind of winner take all also. So these two streams are racing for their first elements, and this guy got first, so then he hijacks the whole output. So then everything from there is this guy winning, okay? So this first one, that's it. I just wanted to. It's very easy. It may be interesting, and we will use the reason also why I picked AMP to be here. We may use it tomorrow to work with the state machines. Okay. You may imagine, for example, I'll give an example here because you may be able to have a feeling for it right now. Which is, let's say, you enter a stage in your trial where there's a choice to be made. Okay, like let's say you have a game and there's like a kind of something is presented and you have to kind of hit, the user needs to give a response very fast, okay? But there's a timeout. So two things can happen depending on what happens first, whether the timeout or the hitting the key, okay? You could use AMP to represent that race condition, okay? So you could imagine that one stream is the effects that will follow a hitting of the key, and the other stream is the effects that will follow the occurrence of the timeout. And at the beginning of that state, they are racing. Okay, so you use AMP to kind of set up this race. We'll get first the hitting the key or timeout, and you could represent that with AMP. Okay. All right. So where we've seen in the first class. So I guess I'll just. But I can show you the reason why I put up here the slide is because I want to show you how you build where in Bonsai. Okay? So we saw the marble diagram, but we didn't see how you define it. So in Bonsai, where is also called a condition. And the way this works, I'll use the mouse as an example. So let's say I had So I have here my mouse values, and let's say it's representing some kind of signal that is coming through. And let's say I only wanted to take values that are higher than 600. Okay, for example. So how do I do that? So you can call condition. Okay, so condition is one of the nodes in the toolbox, and you'll see immediately it's complaining that the specified condition workflow must have a single Boolean output. So what does this mean? So the condition workflow basically means that this condition is a nested workflow. Okay. So this is an example of these functional nestings that I was alluding to yesterday. And the idea is the following. The idea is where and condition needs to test every element, whether it passes the condition, the test, or not. Okay, and the test you specify inside this inner workflow. Okay, so here I'm going to give my test, so it's greater than 600. Okay, that's my test. And now what will happen? So when a value goes through, this nested workflow is run, okay? So the value goes through the greater than, this returns a Boolean. Okay, that's why the condition is happy now, because the output is a Boolean. And now the condition can use that Boolean to decide, this element passed the test, so I'll let it go through. But the important thing to realize here is, inside the test, you transform the value to a Boolean in order to make the test, but the output of condition is actually the same type, is actually the same value that got in, okay? Because this is just a filter. This is just so the inside workflow is just a test on the element to decide whether it is allowed to go through or not, okay? And now you can see, if you see this running, so you have to hear the source, and after the condition, you'll see that only values bigger than 600, so when I'm here, nothing happens, there are values coming through, but they're all failing the test, and when they become greater than 600, they proceed, okay? So that's condition. Another thing that can be useful, because conditions, I mean, there's conditions of many types, and it can be annoying if all of them are called condition, so you can also name the node. Okay, the condition. So to give it some meaning, for you can say great, large enough. Okay. Then it will read large enough, but you will still know it's a condition because it's green. That's why that's why condition is implemented in this way, is because in a sense all the test you specify inside the condition is arbitrary. So this allows you to specify whatever test you want. As long as it returns a Boolean.
In the workflow editor, you're only seeing the stream associated with the test and not the stream that allows large enough to preserve the...
You mean you want to see this guy, yeah?
Well, I guess somehow large enough stores the source value, but just looking at the nested workflow, as you were saying, it just allows a Boolean through?
Yeah. You can see, you can actually see, inspect every element, including this guy. So here you can see the test, okay, the result of the test. So it runs for every element. It's either true or false, or one or zero. But it's only, the value only goes through when the value is one. If it goes to zero, then it stops. That's
I guess in the graphical workflow, I would have imagined two parallel branches, one with the Boolean and one with the number
in the nested, you mean?
Yeah.
But in a sense, it doesn't really matter how the Boolean is produced. So in a sense, one of the powers of this condition is, so for example, here, the reason you have this serial relationship is because the Boolean depends on the input. So in a sense, I have the input, which produces the Boolean. But for example, one funny thing, and this is a good example they probably to give, let's disconnect this. So now the element is disconnected. And now instead of greater than, let's just put, there's a source in Bonsai called Boolean, which is just a constant, okay? Let's plug it in there, okay? So now what happens, I've decoupled both, I've decoupled the test from its elements. And now the thing that dictates whether the element goes through is this arbitrary kind of Boolean variable here. For example, now you can externalize, as we saw before, yesterday, let's externalize that property, okay? And you can say, you can even give it a name, let's say allow. Okay. And now what happens is this is, let's call it door, okay? And you now you have a door, and you have this allow, true or false, okay? So now what happens is, if the door is open, the value is coming through. If I close the door, then nothing happens. Okay. So in a sense, you can what you were mentioning, you can, if you want, in a sense it's arbitrary. So if you want to have the two kind of separate Boolean or you can. It's up to you how the Boolean value is produced. So that this can be, so for example, this is a way to implement if you want to have kind of cut off branches. So if you want to say, let's say you have multiple branches and you only want to run one of them, you can use this.
But in a sense, the Boolean is not the output. The source is the output. That's what I think is...
Well, this is the output of the nested, okay? The difference here is that the nested here is a functional nested. That's why I was alluding... That's why I was... saying yesterday that there's two kinds of nesting. One is just a graphical nesting, which is just a grouping. And the other is a functional nesting, which means you're defining some kind of inner data stream, which has its own output. And that data stream is being used to do something that is not just a piping the value out. You see? Maybe it's confusing, but...
It's a nested workflow when necessary.
You could remove it, yeah. You could remove the, if you don't, sorry, let me start. You could remove it, and then you don't see it. Because you're not, so. No, this is what you were asking, right? No?
You're still nesting.
What do you mean this input here?
Yeah.
Well, if you're not, it requires always an input, because if you don't, you need something to filter, right? Or else there's no way to produce an output. So this is a test.
That was asking if nesting is necessary. It's just a way of creating necessary. Yeah.
If you can specify a condition without nesting,
you're
saying, by just writing something.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you can. There's a couple of ways. Yeah. You can. So one way, but you have to write some kind of little code. So Another type of condition that exists is you have a Python condition, okay? So this allows you to write a little Python script that kind of tests the value in a little function. So for example, I could say value greater than 600 here. And now this is my test, okay? So now it's doing the same thing as before, filtering the stream. But now it's dependent on the little piece of code you put here. Okay, is this something like, or were you imagining something else? There may be in the future other ways to do this. Like for example, maybe you could have. That's true. There could be a node where you just write a little expression here with the test. That could work. So. Yeah. No, but even more. So, for example, in Bonsai, you also have the Python transforms, but you also have this expression transform, which is basically a way to do kind of short inline expressions. So, if I want to take the square, I can say it is just represents the input. For example, I can just say it times it, and this gives me the square of the, well, it looks similar in this case, it's just scaling, but. But you can write, instead of using Python, you can also write these little inline expressions. So you could imagine having a condition where you could also write the expression inline. Anyway, this is for the future. But for now, that's what we have. Okay. So
where
now,
is the condition?
Yeah. Sorry?
So where is condition?
Sorry?
Where?
Where is condition? Yeah, yeah. Just because just reading the workflow, seeing where there, it doesn't make as much sense as when you're writing the textual code. Okay. Sometimes it's also called, so there's many names for these nodes. Even if you go to Rx website, they have many different names for the same operators, depending on the language. For example, JavaScript select is called map. Select is called map in JavaScript, and where is called filter. Now, I didn't use filter because filter also has other connotations in signal processing, and it could be confusing. So in the end, I was thinking about it, and I decided to use a condition, which is a condition. Anyway. Okay. So now we will go through a very important operator, okay? And I'm showing select to kind of get you ready for it. And it's an operator that you'll see will raise many many questions and many many different ways of using it over time. We'll use it quite often. But I want to try like a simple way to kind of explaining it. I think this can make the point quite easy. Okay, so let's start with select. This is our select, okay? So it takes a string and has some function that maps the input values to something else. And that function is applied to every element, so you get a stream of the transformed elements. Okay? Now, another operator that exists in Rx is select many. Okay. So what is select many? So it shares the same name as select, so it should be similar in some way. Okay. And it is. But the idea is that here, whereas for every element, you select only one result, here it's a map. Here, with select many, you can select many results. That's the meaning of the name. Okay. So what I'm saying here, the function, you also have a function that maps the input to the output. But in this case, the function can be something like this. So let's say for every circle, I produce two diamonds in sequence. Okay. So this is like its own internal kind of nested timeline. And you see, so when the first circle arrives, the output just sends out two diamonds, okay, in sequence. Now, when the green arrives, you start sending out the two diamonds in sequence. But now, what happens is that, let's say, so this is a temporal meaning, right? So this is actually a time over here, okay? So what happens if before the green sequence is done with sending out the two diamonds, you have another input coming in, okay? It can happen. What happens is, well, everything will kind of be merged together. So that's the semantic for a select menu. So what it just means is that the green arrives, two diamonds are sent out, they are here. Blue arrives, two diamonds are sent out over here. Their order is respected. But they will be interleaved like this, okay? And we will see select many actually can also be seen as a particular case of something else, but for now, it's just useful to know. Okay, so this allows you to, for every input value, define kind of a whole stream of values that result from that value. Okay. So select many values. That's how you select many. The many here means a sequence. Okay. Is this clear? This is, yeah? You'll see. You can get very creative with select many. Okay? But we will see. But if you remember, if you always remember that this is what is happening, that you have one input being mapped to many, then I think you'll be fine. Okay. All right. So now let's starting, we're, I think, almost getting to the, only a couple more to go, I think, but they're interesting in their own way. Okay, so one is a buffer, okay? So buffer, what does it do? So buffer, what you want to do is you want to not process the, this happens when you don't want to process the elements in the sequence one by one, but you want to process them in batches, little batches, for whatever reason. Okay. So what you say, if you say to buffer, okay, I want buffers of some size, say the size. And by default, if you don't say anything else, buffer will do this. So it will take, if in this case, buffer is of size 3. So when you get 1, 2, 3 elements, when the third element arrives, buffer outputs a list with the three values. Okay, and then it starts a new buffer, and then 1, 2, 3 arrive, and you get a buffer of the three elements. Okay, so if you don't say anything, that's the behavior, is these buffers are non-overlapping. Now, buffer has an additional parameter that I'm not showing here. It's called skip. That allows you to control how many elements are skipped before a new buffer starts. Okay. And actually, the default would be, in here, if you say buffer count 3, then this means buffer count 3, skip 3. Okay, so it's the skip is the same as the count, which means non-overlapping buffers. So it means whenever I get 3 elements, so I start the new buffer, and I get 1, 2, 3 elements, and after I skip those 3 elements, I start the new buffer. But if you said, for example, buffer size 3, skip 1, okay, then you would have kind of mixed buffers. Okay, so you'd have overlapping elements in the buffers. So for example, I don't have it drawn here, but you could draw it on the board if you want. But for example, if you had buffer count 3, skip 1, then you have another buffer over here, which would be yellow, green, blue. Okay.
What's the inverse operation?
Sorry.
The inverse operation of the buffer. If you want to do the inverse thing, right? You have.
So you have a list of values, and you want to flatten it to the,
yeah,
to this. So it turns out one way to do it is using select many. And why? Because you'll see that naturally, a buffer is a sequence, okay? It's one element, is a sequence. So now what you're doing, if you look at select many, imagine you replace this circle with the buffer, okay? So now your input is a buffer, and the output is a sequence of the elements in the buffer, okay? If you do that, then by flattening, like what select many is doing, you would get the flattened sequence of every one. Is that?
But you use the take one.
You don't even need it, because it's already a sequence, right? So it's, in this case, it's a particular case, because your input is already a sequence, you can just send it out, and it will get flattened. Actually, in this case, if you wanted to undo buffer, you could just put select many.
When you read out from the buffer, is the temporal structure maintained?
Maintained, yes. So the order, so this is actually a list, so you can even index it with a name. You can index it. But the relative order is preserved. You don't know the temporal, what you lose is the temporal order. Sorry,
that
maybe that's what you were asking. No, it's not preserved. So you only know that the relative order. You know that
okay.
This one was before the other one.
And merge buffers.
Hmm?
I have like buffers of 3 and I want to, now I have 6.
You do want to do what?
If I have buffers of 3 and then I want to merge.
To merge them?
Yeah.
Yeah, then you need to concatenate the list. So you could take the sequence of the list and kind of you could, for example, take groupings. You could buffer. So if you have a stream of lists, you can now buffer this stream of lists, okay, for example. And every two lists, you kind of add them, for example. It's one way to do it. Or you could undo buffer and then rebuffer again. There's a couple of ways to do it. Yeah.
So we have a discussion.
Yes.
Can you make the running errors by combining select many, a buffer, and a mean?
Yes, that's exactly how running average is implemented in the Bonsai paper, figure 3, I think, as the running average implemented in exactly this way. Using actually, it uses not buffers, it uses the next operator that I will describe, window, which is more efficient in this case. Let's go there. But yeah, that's exactly right. Select many. If you have overlapping buffers, okay, then you could use select many to kind of compute the average of each little buffer, which would be the and then with an appropriate offset between the buffers, you would have a kind of a low pass filter version of the of the input, for example. Yeah, you can see this in action. But let me.
But my problem is, as soon as you have an input in select menu, it will perform the operation in select menu.
It will. So the way it works.
So if you put, my problem is, if you put the buffer there.
Yes.
As soon as the first sample comes on, he will not know the future samples. So he cannot perform.
Yeah, you only know the value. You only have access to the values when the buffer is done, right? That's a problem. So the next operator will solve that problem. Okay. That's why that's an important point. We'll get there in just a moment. Okay, so just to a variation of buffer. So this we saw a buffer that is defined by these little numbers, count and skip. Okay? Another variation of buffer is a trigger buffer, in which you can send a trigger, another string that is a trigger that tells you when the buffer should be closed and the new one opened. Okay? So in this case, you're getting the stream of inputs at some rate, and then a buffer is being accumulated with all the elements, and then when you see the trigger, it will give you all the elements that have been accumulated over that period of time. Okay, so in a way, you can think of this also as an extension of sample, right? So sample had a buffer of one. If you want to have an arbitrary number of, so if you wanted to know all the elements that occurred before the trigger, you could use buffer. And you get it. This is in this way. Another way to think about this. Yeah. So this is the trigger buffer. Yeah. Just the same thing. Now let's look at the more interesting variants, which now that you've seen buffer, it should not feel so weird, but it's very useful, is window. So window, this is a very important one, and you'll use it extensively as well. Window works exactly like buffer, but the output, instead of being a list, which is only sent out when it's completed, when it fills up, here, what you're creating is a sequence of sequences, okay? So this is where the meta part starts happening, but it's essentially here, the graphical representation of this, if you see what's coming out, so there's two, I don't know if you can see, maybe the color was not so fortunate. So there's actually two colors of arrows here. I don't know if it's visible from your angle. From here, they look the same, so I don't know if you can... One is gray, these three are gray, and these are black, okay? So if this is not clear, sorry, maybe the color scheme is not perfect. But anyway, what happens is the black arrows represent the actual input of window, okay? And the gray ones are helpers, and I'll explain what the helpers are. So if you look at just the black arrows, the output of window is this sequence, okay? This is the sequence, okay? Then you get another sequence here. So in fact, remember this is like buffer. So you have a window count three. So before you had buffer count three, and you had two outputs, two buffers. Okay. Now you have window count three, so you get two windows, and then the end. This is exactly the same. Now what is a window? A window is just another observable sequence. Okay. So it's a sequence in itself. So that's how it's represented here, like that. Okay. Now, what is interesting about this? It is interesting because if you get the sequence, you get the window here immediately, as opposed to at the end. Okay? And what this means is, as soon as you get the window, you can immediately subscribe to it. Okay? Because it's an observable sequence. If you subscribe to that window, then when the elements that make up the window come through, they will immediately be propagated through that subscription. So this is kind of like a buffer. This is kind of like buffer, but where you can immediately start consuming the values.
So the first element of the sequence is another sequence, right?
Yes. So actually, window starts immediately. So before even any elements go through, the window starts with a sequence, which is the sequence of whatever the first element will be. And then it starts. Okay? And then when the three elements arrive, I have my three elements here. So I terminate the sequence and I start a new one. So I immediately, even before these ones arrive, I start a new sequence. And then I get three, I close, and I start the next one. Okay? Question.
So window is hot, but object count is hot.
Window is hot, I believe.
No,
with respect to the it depends.
Source.
It depends on what actually depends on how you. It depends on the temperature of this source.
Just to be concrete. So let's suppose we have a video stream coming in, a hot source. Yeah. We put it into buffer, we get a cold. We get something cold coming out.
Exactly.
It's hot.
The reason why I was hesitating is because we will see uses of window later where you can be so again, this is the numerical version of window where you just say, okay, I want windows of three elements, blah blah blah. And then you have more flexible variants where you can even define what is the window. And in those variants could actually completely reprogram the sequence that is actually coming out. So you can actually make not this one, but the more flexible variance actually allows you to send whatever temperature sequence you want as an output. But for this one, yeah, you're right. If you had like a hot camera, then if you miss the values here, so let's say you get the sequence. But if you only subscribe here, you would not see the red.
Buffer is not hot.
Buffer is not hot. In that sense, yeah, because you use caching. Yeah. So it's.
And if you're subscribing, do you get kicked off after one window completes, or what prevents you from thinking that the stream is done?
Which one? All of it?
No.
The little one, yeah. So in this case, if you have window count 3, this sequence is terminated when the new one is started. So when this guy is about to start, it first stops this guy, completes the sequence, and then starts a new one.
But if I'm, let's say, doing an operation on the output of window, am I led to believe that everything is over and I should just quit?
Here, you mean?
If you are doing an operation, what's going to happen is that it's a node where the source terminates and then starts again, and then you are going to the system on the main sequence, right?
Yeah, you can have a.
If you have the count or the reading, you are going to have a sequence of three.
Yeah. So, one thing to realize here, maybe it's good to show. Just this running a little bit. So let's put here. So if I put here buffer, okay, and I say my example count 3. So the first thing to realize, so the output of this guy is a point, okay. The output of this guy is a list of points, okay. Now if I put here a window, actually it's called because there are many variants of window. So there's many. If you write window, there will be. Many little variants. This particular one is called element count, so it has the count. So if you say 3, then the output of this is now an observable of points. Why? Because this is a sequence. So this is assumed, it's already a sequence, right? So it's a sequence of observable of points. So a sequence of sequences. It's that's the
if you do the sum of that sequence I will have a sequence of the counts of each of the sequences.
If you're counting inside. So now the question begins. How do I use this? Okay, because now it's a sequence of sequences, okay, it's all fine, but how do I, because now there's many things you might want to do to these windows. Okay, that's where window becomes quite interesting. Actually, further on, Zach, you were saying that buffer is hot versus cold. There's another way, just for clarifying. Buffer is cold anyway. Okay, I'll not go into this. Buffer is cold. Sorry, this is something I... Because when you start getting... What I was thinking is when you start getting into these kind of... meta-sequences, then you can talk about the temperature of the inner sequences versus the temperature of the outer. Because now you have two. You have the outer sequence of sequences, and you have the inner sequences. And now you can talk about the temperature of each one of these sequences. So there's some things you could get complicated here, but let's not get into this. Okay. Triggered window. So this is exactly the same as the triggered buffer. So now you have the boundaries of the window defined by these other sequences. Okay. So what happens is a sequence is started. Okay. And whenever you get an input in this guy, you complete the sequence and you start a new one. Okay. And the sequences respect the temporal order. Okay. So this is it. You can also see. Another way to look at triggered window is as a splicing operator. So you're kind of cutting, if you imagine going with scissors, where the initial timeline is, you go there with scissors and you're kind of clipping it, and the same relationship, the same distances between elements will be preserved in the inner sequences. Okay?
When you're doing the buffer,
sorry?
When you buffer
here, you lose the temporal. So in a way, this is the answer to Dennis's question. So with buffer, you lose the temporal relationships. In here, they're preserved in the fact that the sequence will be emitted in the proper temporal order, right? So you can kind of keep the temporal structure of the data. Okay. So now what can you do with these windows? So how could you use them? So there's a couple of ways, because now this is interesting because, okay, if it's a list, you can still do many things with lists, but in a way, because you've lost the temporal component with buffer, there's not that many interesting things you can do. With window, on the other hand, exactly because temporal structure is still there, you get many interesting possibilities, okay? So I'll show you some possibilities, okay? So now we have... Let's look at merge again. Okay? Now merge, you can look at merge in a new light if you have a sequence of windows. Okay? If you have a sequence of windows, let's say this guy, okay? And you can see, for example, here I have an example where the windows can even partially overlap, right? So this sequence is going and it's still not over and they already started in another window. Okay? There are different ways to do this. For example, one way is to use so the same as buffer, where you could say count and skip. With window, you can also say count and skip. So you can have overlapping kind of elements. So this thing can happen. Things like this can happen. Or there's other ways. But anyway, so there's two overlapping kind of sequences. And if you have this and you just want to have a result sequence, one thing you can do is you can merge all of the windows. Okay? If you just put merge after the window operator, you will get a flattening out of all the windows, okay, into a result. So this will interleave the elements in all the windows, okay, exactly like select many. And in fact, it's exactly like select many because select many can actually be implemented by using window and merge. So you can see look at select many as this guy defines windows, so sequences of, so if you can imagine that this guy inside, for every element is creating a subsequence of elements and then merging everything. So select many you can see as a window plus merge built into one. Okay. But that's not the only possibility. Okay. Another possibility could be concat. Okay. So now let's imagine, and again this is important to Zach's question, so the let's assume these sequences are cold, okay? Because if it was hot, this would be different. If they were cold, then concatenating the windows, okay, would produce this result. So these windows are overlapping, but because of the concat, what I'm doing is instead of merging, I'm kind of just subscribing to the second window only when the first window terminates. So I wait for everything here, and then at this point, this guy terminates, and then I subscribe to the second window, which, because the window is cold, I get the values preserved in the same order. Okay? If this was hot, then you would have lost this value. Okay? So it's an important... This is an example where the temperature of the subsequences can be important. Another way to kind of impose, so concat, another way, another operator we can do with Windows is switch. This is also a shorthand for a couple of other things, but switch, what it does is the result of switch is always the latest window. So what it does is when you have here a stream of windows, and whenever a new window arrives, you're going to switch to that window. So you stop. So in this case, it doesn't really matter if it's hot or cold, because what happens is you are here, this new window is started, and immediately the subscription to this window is canceled, and you subscribe to the new window and you start from there. So immediately you get this interruption when you start.
Just maybe it's sort of that I understand that if you were just doing normal window, this wouldn't mean anything. But if you had triggered it somehow or more complicated.
Yeah, exactly. All of these are ways that you can use, and we will use them, especially tomorrow when you talk about representing discrete states in data streams. Because now this may become clear after we've seen all these operators, is each of these little sequences, okay, have their own beginning and end. So you can see maybe already with a bit of imagination that you can use this to kind of represent a state, okay? In the sense that this is a sequence that starts of something that is unfolding over time and then ends. So the idea of a running state is exactly this, that you start something, you're doing something for a while, and then you stop, okay? So this will be actually the key. You can think of, we'll not talk about it now, we'll talk about this in detail tomorrow, but if you want to start thinking about it just for tomorrow in the back of your head, how this window operation might actually represent a state, this is an interesting thought experiment to do, okay? And is actually the key to doing it. And then you can see many of these operators in new light. Okay, I'll tell you right away. And tomorrow we'll review, but I'll give you this as food for thought for you to rummage. So if these are now states, okay. Now you can read these operators a bit different. So concat now becomes a sequence of states. Okay, because only after this guy is done, do you go to the next state. Subsequence is a state. You can see merge as a parallel. Okay, so if you have multiple states, if each sequence is a state, then merge is running all the states in parallel. Okay, switch is an exclusive state. So you have a sequence of states, but whenever a new state arrives, you switch to that one. So it's an mutual exclusive. Okay, something like this. So this is, I'll just put it out there so you think about it. Think about it because it's actually a very powerful, we'll use it to do very powerful things, okay? So maybe now, so we managed to finish, yes, in the time that I wanted. Cool. So now I think we will break. I think some of you may have to go, I don't know, but for the others I want to, we will look after the break. Let's break for 5 minutes. And then after the break, I'll just show a couple of examples. I'll show one example of this running. And then tomorrow we'll look into much more practical examples in more detail. And also today I want to discuss a bit the assignments. But yeah, but for now let's break. A couple of minutes. Okay, let's just wrap up a little bit. I just want to explain one more combinator that came up during the break. I think it's interesting to look at. I think it's here on the websites. So again, this is, we have all of the operators we discussed are here with the marble diagrams. But one that I wanted to discuss is scan. Let me see if I have. So scan is interesting It's supported in Bonsai, and I'll show you how it's supported. It's kind of interesting because it's an example of a combinator that allows you to have feedback in Bonsai, in Bonsai workflows, okay? And the reason it allows you to have feedback is because the way scan works, so you take an input data stream, okay? And you pass the function that takes two elements, okay? And produces a result. And what are the two elements? Because here, there's only one input scan, okay? So the two elements, the second element here, or I think rather the first element, means the previous result of the function. Okay, so the way it goes is like this. You take the first value, and initially the first output is only that value. And then when the next value arrives, the function is called with that value and the previous value, okay? And then you can see what happens. In this case, you're adding, so the output becomes, so this is 1 and 2, the output is now 3, okay? And then when the next element arrives, that output becomes the input. So now you have 3 plus 3, 6, okay? So this allows you to kind of build, for example, an integration with feedback or kind of building up on something you did previously. So if you have the help of these combinators, that's how you can, in Bonsai, kind of build feedback, even though you cannot close a connection. You cannot take, for example, the output of this guy and feed back. So let's see an example of this. So I took the mouse coordinates and I add scan, okay? And now if you see, scan is not happy because it says the output must have a single output of the same type as the accumulation. So what does this mean? Well, scan is also a nested workflow, okay? And the nested workflow is basically implementing the function that you were seeing here, this little function. So what does scan do? So the scan is interesting because the input to this nested workflow is an element accumulation. So you have, it gives you access to both the accumulation, the ongoing accumulation, and the value. Okay? So basically this plays the role of the two arguments that were given to this function. Okay, so you can access them here. So for example, if I just want to add, I can just say add, should, I need to take the individual, I need to take the value and the accumulation, okay, then I can zip them and the add. And if I do this, now the output of the add becomes the accumulation on the next run, okay? So what it means is you're kind of, adding every element to an ongoing integration, okay? So now if you run this, scan is forever increasing, sometimes less, sometimes more. Always kind of integrating the input with feedback. Okay. And this can be anything. So for example, if I do the camera, again, scan works because you can add two images. So now it becomes accumulating all of the buffers. But this does not necessarily need to be in addition, it could be something else. It could be an average, or it could be anything that you want. But the point here that I think is interesting for scan is that it shows you an example of how with the operators you could feedback results to the to the next computation. Okay? That's the idea. Okay. So to end, and then we have to finish for today, is I just want to show you an example, again, for you to think about for tomorrow when we talk about states, of how you can use Windows to kind of do something interesting. And I'll give an example that tends to be useful. So let's say I have my camera screen, okay? And I want to split this screen into, let's say I want to save videos of this camera, but I don't want like a one long video. I want like many videos aligned on some event, let's say. Okay? So one way to think about this is you can, as I was saying, window is kind of a splicing operator, so let's use window. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use triggered window as a way to cut the video stream into sub-videos. Okay? Think about it. And I'm going to do this aligned on a key press. Okay? So whenever I hit a key, I splice my sequence into another subsequence. Okay? And then now what I will do is essentially use select many, okay? And so why am I using select many? So that now I have a sequence of sequences, okay? So a sequence of these little windows. And each window has its own little video. And now what I want to do is I want to take for each, so remember to do what select many does, is for each input, it gives you another sequence, okay, and kind of flattens everything. So what I want to do, and one thing that is important, and hopefully this point will be easier to get across this time, is what would happen, the discussion is, what would happen if I now, so we know that if I want to save a video, I can just put here video writing, okay? This is a sync. This will, when you start the workflow, will create a video, okay? And dump all the frames into that video, kind of save it. Now, what will happen if inside the select menu, okay, I take my subsequence of images, and I put the video writer inside here, okay? So now, if you remember from select many, let's go back actually. So in select many, for every element, you produce a sequence, its own sequence. So each sequence is kind of independent, okay? So this represents the subsequence processing. So this guy, in the beginning, is the first sequence of videos. And when this sequence starts, it will start its video, okay? Now, when I hit a key, I will stop the previous sequence and start a new sequence, okay? And what will happen is that this inner workflow will start again, okay? And when it starts again, because now it's another sequence, you can think of what's inside this little nested workflow is each of the subsequences, okay? And you can see that they are independent from each other. You can think about them as independent of each other. So every sequence, in a way, will run this workflow with its own video writer, okay? So the video writer will be initialized and used for each of the subsequences, okay? It's like you're really running this once for each sub-video. So now I can give it a name. Let's say, for example, video.avi. One thing that is a problem is if the file name is the same, then you'll always try to overwrite the same video, which may be fine. You may put overwrite true, and then you only keep the link in the last video. But another thing that is a convenience of this node is you can add a little suffix to the file name. So, for example, a file count or a timestamp. Let's put a timestamp. And this will take the name that is given here and add the timestamp, for example. Okay. If you wanted other ways, this is a convenience. So if you wanted other ways to do this, you could externalize the file name property and kind of build whatever name you wanted. But as a convenience, it, you can also add the suffix.
Still need to write at the end.
AVI, yeah. Yeah, this extension is actually important that AVI is the... Other containers might work, but the AVI is the most compatible. So I recommend that you use AVI for now.
If you don't write anything,
you can't, it will maybe be a problem. Yeah, we should try.
Before it just doesn't.
Yeah, I think it's still a problem. I think it creates a video, but because if you don't specify the container, the video will not make any sense. But anyway, before we do that experiment, let me just show what it's supposed to do. So what's happening now is I have. Well, in fact, nothing will happen with the video because it will always keep running. But if you go here to my documents, you will see that a video is already here being saved. Okay? Why? Because the triggered window starts, the first thing it does is it starts a sequence, and then the key down is only used to stop and start another one. So whenever I hit a key, it can be any key, okay, a new video appears. Okay? Because it, what happened is the And the previous video is complete, so I can even see what it is. So that was the first video. This is actually the other camera. So I can do, let's say, I did another key. Maybe I could try something more interesting. Let's see if I use this camera. Okay. I have this camera. This is, so, for example, let's say... that I want videos aligned on a key press, so I'm going to hit a key, okay? That was the key press, and I'm going to hit it again, okay? And now the idea is that these last two videos should start at key press. Yeah, so you see they begin at key press, okay? And proceed from there, okay? And they again do the same thing, so it's kind of like a... All right.
The window may have a count as well.
Now, yes, which is very interesting. So this allows you to have. So by default, if you don't say anything, triggered window will produce non-overlapping windows. So when the event arrives, it stops the previous window and starts a new one. Okay. But sometimes you may want to have overlapping windows. So for example, let's say you wanted videos that are aligned on some event, and you want, let's say, 2 seconds of video, but you want to account for overlapping. So if during those 2 seconds, another event arrives, you want to start another video in parallel. That kind of, so for example, double key press. Let's say that I wanted to catch, whenever I hit the key, I want to save 2 seconds of video always, but if I hit A twice, quickly, I want to have still the two videos, right? So there's frames that are shared between both videos, right? So you could say that. You could say to trigger window, for example, you can say, I want 2 seconds of video or of whatever is here, aligned on this.
And if you don't define
it? If you don't define it, it's non-overlapping. So the, when you, whenever you... you
so the way it waits for the next queue, next for the next trigger.
It stops the previous window and opens a new one. And the reason this is because otherwise you would have just many, many windows infinite forever, right? And that would be a problem. So the default behavior is non-overlapping. If you want overlapping, you pass this.
And the count is frames.
Count is the number of elements, yeah. So it's frames in this case or whatever.
Yeah.
Can be 60, can be whatever, yeah.
What if you specify both?
If you specify both, it's either. So if you get 60 frames, it stops. If if 2 seconds passes, it stops.
Okay.
So whichever one happens first.
Okay.
So let's see what happens. So for example, now I look. Let me see camera here. So again, so now if I get key, I'm going to hit it twice quickly, so one, two, already exists. Ah, it happened the same second. Yeah, the suffix is now not good. Sorry. You see what, so what happened? So basically the timestamp, if it happened in the same second, so the suffix was not enough to differentiate the two files, it complained. So let's use file count, okay, for now. You could use other, you can use, as I said, this is a convenience, so you could use other strategies to name the files if you want. But anyway, let's try again. So one, two. Okay. Now I should have hopefully two files called video 6 and video 7, because the count is actually the number of files called video. So anyway, so you see, that was the first, this was the first video, so it includes the, starts on the first key press, and of course also catches the second key press, because it's 2 seconds after the first. And then the second video only has one key press, which is the second key press. And starts 2 seconds after that. So, so this is, yeah. One example of using these nodes we talked about, of splicing the streams in subsequences and using them to kind of, this is already an example of a state in a way, again, to make, get you think for tomorrow. And you can think of this little sub workflow as it's a state that starts when an event happens, it runs for some time, and then it stops. And then you can have, in this case, we put select many because it's merging. If you remember, select many is kind of like window processing plus merge. So merge, if you remember, is running states in parallel. So that's why, in this case, we do want to run two states in parallel because you can have overlapping kind of things happen. Sometimes you don't. You could concatenate them. Anyway, that's it for today. Okay, I think, yeah. I think it's, we're done. Cool. Thank you very much.